All right. My name is Lee Spiller, and I'm the Executive Director of the Citizens Commission on Human Rights in Texas. We're a mental health watchdog group that's dedicated to exposing and eradicating fraud and abuse in the area of mental health. And you might ask, well, why such a specialized thing? Isn't there abuse? Aren't there encroachments on personal liberty in plenty of other areas? Yes, there are. Unfortunately, the mental health field is one of those fields where you can be labeled based on a checklist of behaviors. There's no way to verify by a brain scan, lab, x-ray, blood test, urine test, whether or not you have a mental illness. And then that label can follow you around. It can affect your life in very profound ways. And we'll find out more about that as we go along. Thanks to Libertarian Party of Texas for having us here. And a few months ago, actually, no, I'm sorry, it was 2015. Working down at the Capitol, I met Mark Miller and I met Ben Farmer. Anyway, I got to find out more about these libertarians. And there were a few principles that I read that I really, really liked. You know, we've all heard the word libertarian, but what does that really mean, right? These were the ones that struck me. As libertarians, we seek a world of liberty, a world in which all individuals are sovereign over their own lives, and no one is forced to sacrifice his or her values for the benefit of others. Yeah, I would subscribe to that. We believe that respect for individual rights is the essential precondition for a free and prosperous world, that force and fraud must be banished from human relationships, and that only through freedom can peace and prosperity be realized. Right? Consequently, we defend each person's right to engage in any activity that is peaceful and honest, and welcome the diversity that freedom brings. The world we seek to build is one where individuals are free to follow their own dreams in their own ways without interference from government or any authoritarian power. Y'all hand me a hello, okay? It's just pretty much that simple. There's some parallels between that and what we do. These are some excerpts from CCHR's Mental Health Declaration of Human Rights. Right. The whole idea that human rights include the right to one's own mind and to protect oneself and one's loved ones against any abusive or harmful treatments given under the guise of mental health. The idea that no one should be forced to undergo any psychiatric or psychological treatment against his will. No person, man, woman, or child should be denied his or her personal liberty by reason of mental illness without a fair jury trial by layman and with proper legal representation, right? Those are some pretty important principles, and that's actually where we interfaced with the Texas Libertarian Party. It was 2015, and there was a Senate bill. It was Senate Bill 359. That said basically that if you walked into a hospital or emergency room for treatment and then changed your mind and didn't want to follow through with treatment, maybe you wanted to leave for whatever reason, and the doctor thought that you weren't right in the head for wanting to make your own treatment choice, they could detain you. They could detain you without a warrant. They could detain you without law enforcement saying grace over it, so you didn't have access to a peace officer who could go, whoa. Now, we're in some pretty weird constitutional territory here, right? It wasn't the first time we had run across that legislation. We've been killing that type of legislation since 2007. Frankly, we didn't really think it had that big of a chance because the legislature had done the right thing all these years. It's actually kind of ironic that it would even come up. And it's even more ironic that I would be speaking to you guys in San Antonio. Because the protections that we have in law against that sort of thing actually stem from a case in San Antonio. There was a boy named Jeremy Harrell who he was home with his grandparents. Everything was fine. And all of a sudden, these guys in uniforms with badges, with lights on the top of their car, and official-looking papers showed up at the house and told Grandma and Grandpa, Jeremy's got to go. They didn't know what this was about. They had no idea what had spurred this on. And Jeremy got institutionalized. And it took days to get him out. These gentlemen that showed up at the house, they were not law enforcement. They were security guards from a private company known as Sector 1 Security. And in San Antonio, it had been decided, hey, you know, we could just farm all this out. We can fill out papers and we can have people picked up. So Jeremy got a detention order from a psychiatrist he had never met, who was completely unfamiliar with his mental state. And Jeremy's grandparents got to digging around and finding out what was going on. And they got a hold of Senator Frank Tejeda, and he started looking into it. And one of the things that made Jeremy so attractive wasn't his looks. It wasn't his mental state. It wasn't the fact that he was being raised by his grandparents. It was his insurance. He was covered by CHAMPUS, you know, what we now call TRICARE, which is the insurance for military dependents. And CHAMPUS would pay generously for mental health benefits. And what unraveled was a nationwide fraud scheme in which ungodly numbers of children were picked up, detained in mental health facilities, basically until the insurance ran out, and then let go. And it actually, at that time, you know, and it wasn't just one hospital chain doing it, it was a lot of hospital chains doing it. People were being paid bounties for referrals. In some cases, school counselors were being provided free of charge to schools, who then turned around and referred students to the hospitals that had provided them. It was massive fraud. It was so bad that in Texas, we actually had to pass a law to allow these inappropriately committed children to clear their mental health record, because these institutionalizations and these diagnoses that were just slapped on for the insurance money were interfering with service in the military, high security employment, things like that. Imagine being told that there's something wrong with you and it'll never change. And that's just the way things are. And having to walk around through life thinking that there's something wrong with you when it was just insurance fraud. Think what that would do to you. What if you felt sad and somebody told you it was something wrong with you? It wasn't a response to something going on in the environment. It was something wrong with you. That's the kind of thing we're talking about. And it affected thousands of children. It affected adults. And so Texas passed a number of laws, including laws that said, well, peace officers get to do detentions. Doctors don't. Hospitals don't. You could have a difference of opinion with your doctor or with a hospital. And whether their motives are okay or not, they also have an interest in your treatment and they have a financial stake in your treatment. And besides, how is it okay to force somebody to treat it? In what other venue would that be okay? If you walked into a hospital with diabetes and you didn't like the way they wanted to go, you could walk out the way the law is today. But somehow if somebody questions your mental health, it ain't so easy. So that's what we were up against. And it was funded by a pretty, you know, multi-million dollar campaign to get this through. And it was interesting because some of the same people who had been sympathetic to these issues in the past, we just didn't have the access. I guess money talks. What I do know is that the legislation, this Senate Bill 359, has sailed through committee, sailed through its floor vote, crossed over to the House, sailed through committee. And, you know, it just really didn't matter what we said. You know, and there were other groups involved. Texas for Accountable Government was an incredible ally. Right? And Mark Miller ended up being an incredible ally once it was out of committee. And, it was a nightmare. So this bill passed both houses of the legislature, and it got sent to the governor. And it was pretty much a done deal. And you know, it's the end of the legislative session. A lot of us have been working 16-hour days for way too long. We're tired. And somebody says, "What do you think? Should we do a veto campaign?" I'm like, "What's the point? This thing passed through. There were 4 no votes in the Senate. There were 12 no votes in the House. We're done." And then this same person found an opinion that the governor had issued back when he was Attorney General, making it clear that it's law enforcement that has that power, not just any old hospital. So we're like, okay, we'll play. So different ones of us started making calls, and you know, Libertarian Party of Texas jumped in, no questions, this has got to be done. And within 24 hours, a letter had been delivered to the governor's office. Everybody was alerting their membership. And we got down to the last day the bills could be vetoed. And you know, I'm checking my computer every hour, man, you know, what's up? And it gets to be about 11:30 at night, and it's time to go to bed and check the computer. And you know, the status, you know, when you're tracking a bill, it'll say different things. It says sent to governor. Well, in Texas, a bill could become law with the governor's signature, or he can not sign it and let it become law without his signature, or he can veto it. Those are the 3 options, right? So that sent to governor, you're waiting to see if it's gonna say effective on such and such a date, or signed by the governor, or vetoed. So 11:30, it says sent to the governor. It's the end of the session. A lot of bills were being sent to the governor, so surely he signed it or let it pass without his signature. I woke up around 4, and I'm like, man, I gotta check this. Look it up right quick on my iPad, and it says sent to the governor. I wake up at 7:30, and I check my iPad, and it says sent to the governor. Okay, we're out of time. So I call the president of our organization, and we're just pretty much talking about how we just got our butts kicked and what are we going to do this summer. And one of the allies in this great veto coalition, it was neat because 15 groups signed on within 24 hours of the decision to have a veto campaign. So one of the allies calls, says, "Lee, check your computer." I said, "There's nothing wrong with my computer." She says, "No, check your computer." "Why? I'm using my iPad." "Lee, would you check the bill status?" Vetoed my governor. And y'all were a big part of that. And it's something we really appreciate. And this was part of some recommendations. A few years back, some groups got together and decided that it was time to rewrite the mental health code. Now you have to understand, most of the really profound rights changes and pieces of mental health law that affect your liberties happened between 91 and 93. Right, that's when bounty hunting was made illegal. That's when the healthcare fraud statutes in Texas got toughened up. That's when shock treatment was banned for children. Right. That's when informed consent for psychiatric drugs was put in. That's when, you know, 2 doctors could no longer get together and decide what was good for you. Now they had to go to court where you actually had a chance of getting blood. All of that happened in that time period, and here we are all these years later, and you've got these guys wanting to rewrite the mental health code. And they wanted to do things like these temporary emergency hold provisions. In other words, let you be held in an emergency room or a hospital without a court or a peace officer saying grace over it. Things like that. There you've got the front page of the veto letter. There you've got the signature page. And there you see Ben Farmer, State Vice Chair of Texas. And you've got the veto. But it's actually going on all over the place, right? Last summer, this article came out about Parkland Hospital in Dallas screening every person that admits to the hospital for suicide. The problem with suicide screening, it's not like you want people to commit suicide, but again, it's subjective. And I'll give you an example, and it really, it goes back to something that was going on while we were fighting this bill. You look at some of these screenings, and instead of saying, have you ever tried to commit suicide, they'll get tricky and ask a question, well, have you ever wished that you could fall asleep and never wake up? I'm going to think about that for a second. So while we're fighting this Senate Bill 359, we get a phone call from a lady whose family. One of her biggest problems was that she was Hispanic, which should not be a problem in Texas. But she spoke broken English. She had a urinary tract infection. She had gotten treatment, but it must not have been the right antibiotic because she went septic. No, she got blood poisoning. One of the hallmarks of sepsis is altered mental status. You're not acting right. So all of a sudden, broken English becomes no English. Right? And her friend is on the phone with her. She's frantic. She really does not want psychiatric drugs. She has a religious objection to them. And she's in the emergency room. Her friend can hear her on the phone saying, no drugs, no drugs. And of course, you know, she's frantic about it. The hospital, they're trying to get an IV in. All these types of things happen. But her friend that's on the phone hears, 1, 2, 3, stick. What does that mean? It means she got an injection. Now, I don't fault the hospital for putting in an IV. I don't fault the hospital for the way they treated this lady for sepsis. They did what you're supposed to do. They got her on IV antibiotics. That was all good. But this lady was banged up with an antipsychotic drug before they even placed the IV. So in other words, she was giving a powerful, mind-altering drug before they even bothered to give her an antibiotic. From there, you know, she gets her initial treatment, the antibiotics are working, everything's going great, they admit her to her room. You have to understand, this lady, she has 2 young grandchildren, and she's been sick for days. How well has she been sleeping? Not good. So what we know at the time is they're saying that she's suicidal, and they're holding her, and they won't let her go. It took a week and a half. She got transferred from the hospital to a psychiatric hospital, and it took about a week and a half to help her get out, in spite of the fact that she was non-dangerous, and she had a pretty large circle of willing, responsible friends and family who were willing to make sure that she was kept safe. And when we get the records, what do we find? What is her suicidal statement? Somebody asked her how she was doing. She went, man, I just wish I could sleep forever. How many times have you said that? How many times have you thought that? It doesn't mean that you wish you could go to sleep and never wake up. It means, oh man, I'm so tired. I wish I could sleep forever. But that was the thing that was pretty much outlined as the suicidal statement. and it took a week and a half to get her out. She got drugs out the wazoo, drugs that she didn't want. And frankly, you know, it was rough. I mean, you know, she was in altered mental status. And, you know, this, one of the sad things about it was that, you know, when we got it reviewed by a doctor, the doctor's going, well, look, you know, one of the things I'm going to look for, if I'm successfully treating this systemic infection, one of the things I'm going to look for is whether or not the altered mental status clears. Now she's banged up on drugs. How do I know? Because she's chemically altered. Right? It just turns into a problem. So please, sooner or later, we're all going to end up going to the emergency room. At this point, we know that they are screening for suicide. Please think twice before you can say you wish you could sleep forever. I mean, it was just that simple, and it shouldn't be that way. So as to this bill, these detentions, the other thing that was interesting is that there's one sheriff's department in Texas that has some mental health deputies that are, I won't say that they're perfect because they're not, but they're pretty rights-oriented. And they were opposed to that bill, and they gave some stats on detentions, because they get called up to the hospital to detain people, I mean, you know, to do evaluations and decide whether or not people can be detained. And they said that 47% of the people that they were called to the hospital for don't meet the criteria for detention. That's almost half. In 1 year, in this suburban, not that big a county, they made 900 calls to hospitals to do detention evaluations. Right? Without those guys doing what they do, all 900 of those patients, had this law been in effect, all 900 of those patients would be detained. And that's just one county. That's a lot of people. Luckily, those guys were there. They do keep people from being detained. But that's how big of a deal it is. Now, when you go to a hospital, it's the right of a competent adult to decide whether or not they want treatment. And a competent adult has the right to refuse treatment, even life-saving treatment. But we've got this problem. And it's going to take a second to explain. What I'm going to say is going to sound like a hateful personality. And there are exceptions to the rule. Psychiatry is to mental health what segregation was to education. And I say that because of this. Psychiatry produces labels. It's not like being black or Hispanic or whatever. You can't see it. But it's a label, and it's still there. And once you have that label, you don't give equal justice. Right? And what did Brown versus Board of Education teach us? They taught it taught us that separate but equal ain't equal. So all of a sudden, you get a mental health diagnosis. Let's say you're in the emergency room. Maybe you were depressed. So now you have a depression diagnosis. And all of a sudden, people are going to doubt your motives. It's almost like there's an inherent fear. Once you put that label on somebody, now they can't think for themselves. Oh, gosh, you've got to worry about whether they're going to commit suicide. That's wrong. And it's so wrong that there was a gentleman named Kenneth Donaldson. And he was put in a mental hospital in Florida for care, for treatment. He was in custody. Kenneth may or may not have had some problems, but one thing Kenneth was not was a danger to self or others. Kenneth did not see liberty for 15 years. 15 years. And he finally, you know, he had to fight it himself, and it got fought all the way to the Supreme Court. What did the Supreme Court say? They said, may the state fence in the harmless mentally ill solely to save its citizens from exposure to those whose ways are different? One might as well ask if the state, to avoid public unease, could incarcerate all who are physically unattractive or socially eccentric. Mere public intolerance or animosity cannot constitutionally justify the deprivation of a person's personal liberty. In short, a state cannot constitutionally confine without more a non-dangerous individual who is capable of surviving safely in freedom by himself or with the help of willing and responsible friends and family members. That's what they said. And that's the standard today. And we go back to that bill that the Libertarian Party helped get vetoed. Essentially, what we're talking about is locking up or detaining non-dangerous individuals based on a treatment decision that they have a right to make, and doing it without court oversight. And granted, it was a four-hour detention. It wasn't 24 hours. But a lot can happen in 4 hours. In 4 hours, you can be coerced. You can be told, you're going to take this. Because if you don't take your meds, you know, you're going to be here a lot longer. And it's always something general like that. And it's usually some sweet person, oh, honey, you better take your drugs, you know, because if you don't, you'll be here a lot longer. Right? But you're in an unequal relationship. And the longer you're in that unequal relationship, the further afield things can go. I don't know that it's by design, it's just the way it is, right? You're up against a learned professional, right? They have data, they deal with this every day, you're like a first-time parent, right? But think about it, if your kid is acting up, or if your kid, something happened, maybe they went out the night before and smoked K2 or whatever, and they're not acting right, and you're taking them to the hospital, who are you going to trust? But then you find yourself there, and then people are telling you you have to do things. And you don't even think to go, okay, who says? Who says I have to? And the next thing you know, you're in the hospital. And you're in the hospital because of a label. And again, that label can't be proven. The labs and x-rays don't have any diagnostic value. We are ruling out a physical problem. And absolutely, people should have labs. They should have blood tests. They should have x-rays. They should have CAT scans. Whatever it takes to rule out underlying physical disease, because the truth is a lot of people that are in inpatient care have underlying physical conditions that will manifest as mental conditions. Dehydration, urinary tract infections, upper respiratory infections, thyroid problems, you can go on and on with this. Right. But that's really what was being violated here, right? And that's one of the things, what we find, and it's interesting because we put people on, say, antidepressants, right? By now we all know there's a black box warning for suicidality on the antidepressants. What some people may not know is that there's some association between antidepressants and a lot of these drugs and aggression. There are a lot of reported cases of aggression. Some of the drugs, like one of the ones that Andrea Yates, that mom who drowned her kids, was taking. If you read the package insert, deep in the package insert, you'll find yourself being warned about homicidal thoughts. This is a big deal, but we're not necessarily associating those two things. Instead, what we do is we try to do things by force. Right? And that's really one of those places where y'all really come in, right? The whole non-aggression principle, right? That whole thing, that is so important, right? What are we doing judging people based on a label? We're judging them based on a concept. We're not judging them based on a deed. And what comes out of that is more and more force. Right? So it is one of those Brown versus the Board of Education things, right? And sure, you can't see the difference. The difference is implied, it's a label. And because of that, we take away the rights of people who are really just like the rest of us, right? A really good example of that is in the criminal justice system. We have a problem in Texas, and it's actually a national problem. The mere mention of, you know, like let's say you get arrested for some reason. Who in here is an activist? Cool. So let's say everything's gone bad, and now you're having to resort to the lowest form of public relations, which is protest. Right? When everything else has failed, you protest. So you go out and you protest, and you go get thrown in jail. The mere mention of mental illness can trigger a process that is largely informal. Somebody has implied that you're mentally ill. Now somebody is going to question whether or not you're competent to stand trial. If it's decided that you are, or that you're likely to be, then you're going to have a hearing. You don't have the right to request a jury trial on competence. Your attorney has to make that call. And because your competence is in question, your attorney may not be representing your wishes. They may be representing your best interests. And there's a difference. Right? So, no right to a jury trial unless your attorney stands up for you. Your initial commitment for competency restoration is 120 days, and there's no appeal. And that's not just a felony thing. You know, the first time somebody told me about somebody being incompetent to stand trial, I'm going, oh yeah, major felon, axe murderer. I get it. Man, I didn't get it. Most people won't get it. That can happen in misdemeanor. Class B misdemeanor, criminal trespass, you name it, right? Class B misdemeanors, Class A misdemeanors. And you can take somebody who may have been in crisis, right? They may have been under stress. They may have been, you know, maybe they're sick. Maybe they do have a mental health diagnosis. Maybe they're suffering drug side effects. But now you've decided that because they're different, they're not entitled to equal justice. Instead, somebody's going to decide whether they need to go away. And they could go away for as long as 120 days that first time before they have to have another hearing. Right? So you can take a person. Well, what can happen in 120 days? In 120 days, you can get evicted. Your car could be repossessed. You can lose your job. Right? You could be going from a person who's having a personal crisis to a person who is now on meds, some of them majorly mind-altering, jobless, homeless, got nothing. And it's just that simple. After that first hearing, if for whatever reason you look to be here's the other thing about it. Remember O'Connor versus Donald, where it talks about a non-dangerous individual, right? Well, that's for civil commitment. For a forensic commitment, there is no element of dangerousness. Dusky versus U.S., that's what they based on. The court ruled that to be competent to stand trial, a defendant must have sufficient present ability to consult with his lawyer with a reasonable degree of rational understanding and a rational as well as factual understanding of the proceedings against him. Right? Let me ask you, you've got a court-appointed attorney who, no matter how good their intentions are, probably can't hire the experts and the others that it would need to be able to really put on a vigorous defense. But you know you're innocent, and your attorney is really telling you the facts of life. They're going, look, man, you better look at pleading this out. And you go, no, man, I'm innocent. I don't want to plead this out. I don't care how many hours it costs you. Do you see how that may not seem reasonable or rational? This guy's got X amount of time. to get the job done, and you're telling him you want all his time, and that's not the facts of life. So you end up with people who, because they can't get along with their attorney, won't listen to a plea deal, won't entertain the notion of a plea deal, can end up being in conflict. They're not dangerous, often charged with a non-dangerous offense, criminal trespass, you name it. I mean, it can be pretty lightweight stuff, right? And then they sit in the jail, and they'll sit in the jail for 20 or 30 days waiting for a psych bed to open up, and then they'll sit in a hospital. Now, if you have a hard time in the hospital and you're not doing well, then at the end of about 120 days, then you're gonna have another hearing on whether to continue this. Now, my understanding is that that hearing dangerousness does come to play. But technically, you could be held under a competency restoration type of commitment for as long as your maximum sentence would have been had you been convicted of the crime. Only at this point of the game, you have not had a hearing on the merits of what you're accused of. Nobody said whether you're guilty or innocent. They've just said, hey, this guy's not competent. Right, so we get to the case of an attorney who happened to represent some unpopular clients, who happened to have beaten a few of these types of, competency allegations. And maybe she was a little bit outspoken. She ends up getting accused of shooting at a census worker. Next thing you know, they're questioning her competence. This is an attorney. This is an experienced criminal attorney. I'm sure she has pretty strong opinions as to how she wants to conduct her defense. She ends up in state hospitals here in Texas for a year and a half. What is competency restoration? Well, I tell you, we were pretty shocked because we started hearing about this, right? And sometimes you're testifying at a legislative hearing and you open your mouth before you think. And of course, there's media watching. It ends up going all over the right. But we had looked at the competency restoration curricula for all the state hospitals. And you're going to get treatment sometimes whether you want it or not. And then on top of that, to make sure that you're familiar with the court process, you're going to get word search puzzles, multiple choice questions, true and false. And then we looked at the competency restoration curriculum for the mentally retarded at North Texas State Hospital. And it includes educational friends like my cousin Vinny. It literally says that in the book. Educational films about the court process like my cousin Vinny. So I find myself testifying on the floor of the Senate. And I bring this up and I go, my cousin Vinny is a great movie. I love that movie. I just wouldn't call it therapy. And of course, that goes everywhere. So here we are dealing with this attorney. Now, luckily, there was a group of reporters that were following her case. And I really think that if it weren't for reporters following her case, there's no telling where she would be today. Her charge was significant enough that I guess if you went by the letter of the law, who knows, maybe she could have been in a state hospital for 99 years without the merits of her case being heard. I don't know, I'm not an attorney, but that's the way it looks, right? It could have been significant, right? But luckily she gets it in the media. And every time they do anything to her, we get a call and we relay the message to the reporters, and so they get on it. And it finally gets so bad in December of 2012, I think it was. One more media story has gone out. Now they've taken away all of her belongings. They've taken away, this is a lady who is writing things. She's working on her appeal. She's working on things for other clients because, frankly, she was so incompetent that she was allowed to practice law from inside the state hospital. And when somebody tried to stop it, then it had to go before a judge. And the judge goes, yeah, she's competent to practice law. But somehow it was okay to hold her in the state hospital. They took away all of her writing materials. She could borrow a gel pen, you know, that's flexible and you can't stick it in your, you know, hurt yourself with it. And so we had to go to the state hospital and we had to go, hey, can y'all please tell us what's going on? We don't get it. Constitutionally, she has a right to her belongings. Black and white letter of the law. A person in a psychiatric hospital in Texas has a right to their belongings. We don't get it. Could we at least get an inventory? Next thing we know, we're in front of the hospital administrator and the head of psychiatry because they recognize my name and they recognize that I love my cousin Vinny and just wouldn't call it therapy. But the outcome was good. 2 weeks later, she was pronounced competent. She did her criminal trial, you know, she's just glad that, to have been out. And that was the most that could be done. But really look at that concept, right? It is a separate but unequal concept, right? It's discrimination. It's not by race, it's by label. And it's unequal justice. And that is the big risk that we run. And to think that this person was actually practicing law while incompetent to stand trial. It's ridiculous. It's something that needs to be overturned. Now, Dusky makes it hard because apparently that's what it takes to be incompetent, right? But shouldn't there be an element of dangerousness? If you're going to incarcerate somebody, shouldn't they be committing a crime? And if you're incarcerated, does it really make any difference whether you're incarcerated at the Four Seasons or your own home or a jail? You're still incarcerated. And this is a huge liberty issue, and it is playing out on thousands of people in our state every year. These are the liberty issues. You know, most of us, when we think about liberty issues, we think about staying out of jail, get to conduct our business as we want, get to take care of our family as we want. But there's this whole set of liberty issues that's right under our nose that we don't necessarily look at. And it is the liberty of labels and what happens to you once you have them. And unfortunately, it's happening way too often. If 900 people in 1 year in one county can be perceived as mentally ill at the emergency room, and people can attempt to detain them, that's a lot of people, right? If our state hospitals are so full of criminal defendants that there's no place to put people when they're actually in a crisis, now I'm not a fan of forced treatment, period. But let's suppose for a moment that there is somebody out there that is so bad off that they're really unsafe for other people and they belong someplace nicer than jail. Don't you think that you should have every protection possible for their rights? And don't you think that that bed that they would go to shouldn't be full of criminal defendants who aren't dangerous? If you aren't dangerous, you shouldn't be locked up. We've got, I want to say, 2,700 state hospital beds in the state of Texas. I may be a little bit off, but I think it's around 2,700 beds. And they're so full year-round that somebody who's actually in a crisis can't get in. Now, I'm the last one that would argue for more psychiatric. I promise you that. But to misuse people who are accused of some misdemeanor crime, or even a felony for that matter, and they're non-dangerous, and not to allow bail, just like for anybody else, all because they have a label. Man, that's injustice. That's complete injustice. So again, psychiatry is to mental health as segregation was to education. Yeah. Shot him, shot her around the world. Okay. Unfortunately, this stuff doesn't, it doesn't stop in Texas, and there is a movement right now to really encroach on the rights of people with mental health issues. There's a bill called the Helping Families in Mental Health Crisis Act in Washington, D.C. It's H.R. 2646. And it creates a series of grants that states can get. And you know, our state is so good about going after that federal grant money. But a big portion of this bill has to do with what is called assisted outpatient treatment. Or they may call it outpatient commitment. The assistance is force and coercion. You're not dangerous enough to be incarcerated somewhere. So in other words, we must be applying this to people who are not quite dangerous. It's not supposed to work that way. If people are not quite dangerous, you leave them alone and you let them go about their own affairs and you let them make their own treatment choices. And the gentleman behind this bill has an interesting theory. And his theory is that, if you've got a serious mental illness, just because you can look me in the eye and just because you're walking and talking doesn't mean that you can understand anything. It doesn't mean that you can understand you're sick. And they've come up with a new diagnosis for that. Is anybody here familiar with, it's called the DSM?
Yes.
It's the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. We call it psychiatry's billing Bible. It has all the diagnoses in it. You gotta have that diagnosis and that code to be able to bill for treatment. So it's their billing Bible. But you know, pretty much anything you could do is in there. Think about sex too much? It's in there. Don't think about it enough? It's in there. I don't know what just right is. But it's all in there. Every one of those disorders is voted into existence. Voting. And unfortunately, when they were looking at some of the categories, as many as 86% of the guys that were voting on them had conflicts of interest. But there's a new diagnosis. It's called anosognosia. And it's a lack of self-awareness. The term came about because in certain stroke victims and brain injury victims, doctors notice that you have some guy that's paralyzed on the left side or whatever. He's trying to put on his shirt, can't get it over his shoulder, and then he's sitting there like he's all dressed, completely unaware that he's got a disability, right? Well, and that's a simple explanation, right? But that, that's in response to an actual physical lesion that can be identified, right? Sure, it could be anywhere, but it's like an expected thing. You've got somebody with a known injury, and sometimes it happens. They took a lot of brain scan studies on schizophrenics who wouldn't take meds, and they found that a certain percentage of them had some problem with their brain. Maybe it was asymmetrical, maybe it had a little lesion, whatever. But what was interesting, that collection of studies, they couldn't all point to any one thing. It's like, okay, so what you're saying is that your collection of studies is more likely to point out that sometimes people with actual brain abnormalities are misdiagnosed as schizophrenic. Isn't that what you're really talking about? Because there's not a brain scan that'll show you schizophrenia, but there is a brain scan that'll show you brain damage. Right? And I don't know if this will play video with audio. Will it? We'll try. Because I want y'all to hear this in the guy's own words.
Nothing else, turn up the speakers on your laptop.
Oh, that's right.
Okay, we're not going to have any fun here. But, you know, essentially, the theory is that people, because of a label, are not competent to make their own treatment choices. And his bill is being considered right now. Now, luckily, it has slowed down a little bit. About 109 different groups have signed on in opposition to this. Because we're talking about forcing non-dangerous people to take mind-altering drugs while they're still just fine to live in their own home. That is a huge intrusion on rights. There was some research in New York and in one of the Carolinas where they aggressively used these type of laws, and it showed that black people were about 5 times more likely to be outpatient committed. Hispanic people were about 2.5 times as likely to be outpatient committed. So obviously they were concerned, so there's been some pushback on that bill. I'm telling you, we're gonna need y'all. We're going to need to all stand together because, unfortunately, this bill isn't the only one pushing for this kind of thing. Senator Cornyn has a bill that has an outpatient commitment bill. I'm a component. It happens, and it is already the law in certain states, in fact, most states. But there's usually some protection or some limitation where it's only really applies to a very limited number of people. This is broad. And I don't think the fact that you're unlikely to take medication should be one of the criteria for locking you up. Because one of the most basic choices you have is what gets done with your body. Yes?
One of the things I've learned in my political activism is that when you're trying to defeat a bill, one of the best things you can do is connect it to the money, right? If you can follow money, the public does react to that.
That's correct.
And so is there a way that you can help me as an activist see a money trail, some way to connect this for defeating this bill, specifically Mr. Cornyn's?
Let me look at that.
Okay.
Let me look at that. I certainly
that helps a lot when you're trying to communicate to the public that it needs to be killed if you can follow a line of bad money or something.
Yeah, exactly. And that research actually needs to be done because the argument right now is, look, we're not going to have to put him in the psych hospital. We're not going to have to spend that $500 a day to put him in the state hospital. We'll spend $120 a day and force them to take treatment as an outpatient. Okay. Sounds really good. Now they're going to have to monitor for medication compliance. Well, how do you monitor? Right now, you bring people in on a routine basis and you drug test them.
Oh.
Yeah, there it is. That's all over. Now, we're in the era of smart pills. These should come on the market this month. It is a pill. You swallow, it lets your doctor know that you took it.
What? Can you repeat that?
It is a smart pill. You take the pill, it has a chip in it, it has a little metal strip that interacts with your stomach acid to create electricity. It transmits to a patch that you wear on your belly, which amps up the signal, transmits it to a cellular device, which then transmits it to your doctor. They can know where you are and whether or not you took your drugs. That's the era that we live in.
So you have a GPS box.
If you're on cell, you know, you can be triangulated.
Yeah.
So that's the era that we're living in. Luckily, this has slowed down, you know, but it's something we need to be aware of, and we definitely all have to hang together on this because we will certainly, I don't remember the exact quote, but we will certainly hang apart. Thank you all very much.